It is my pleasure to introduce our esteemed panel. We have J. Bob Alotta, who is the Executive Director of Astraea Lesbian Foundation for Justice. We have Alison Bernstein, Director of the Institute for Women's Leadership, Rutgers University, and as you all know, the former Vice President for the Knowledge, Creativity, and Freedom Program, which I always love the description of that, at the Ford Foundation, and most recently at the Camille and William Cosby, was served as the Camille and William Cosby Visiting Professor at Spelman College. Rashid Shabazz, thank you so much for being with us. You know, it gives another, when I saw that he was on the panel, I said, oh, gender, male, okay. He's a program officer of the Soros Foundation and heading up the Black Male Achievement Program there. And Jessica Stern, who is the acting executive director, congratulations, of the International Gay and Lesbian Human Rights Commission. Thank you all, J. Bob. If you could start, our main topic is philanthropy and how it promotes gender justice, but I think for the audience, it's how you, we'd like to hear first, how you came to this work, why you think it's so important, and if you feel that this day, this is a good place to be, are you optimistic or worried?
I'll get to the justice part first, maybe. So it seems to me that what it means to head an organization that's called the Lesbian Foundation for Justice, and in the year 2012, my understanding and the way that I've been able to move into that position is that it was founded in the basis and birthed from lesbian feminism. And to me, what it meant to be kind of the second generation of leadership there was to embrace, and I feel like I came out of that movement as well as a child. And so to embrace the notion that lesbian feminism, justice, and justice were inextricably linked. 94% of Astraea's funding goes to people of color-led organizations. So as far as representing the organization, it's my understanding then that lesbian feminism and justice is also synonymous with a call for racial equity. To have made that decision, and I understand it then as a strategic decision, it's to say that in order to envision a just future, we have to tackle systemic disparity. I think that I'm optimistic because I've never understood survival as being a trope. That I knew that often I was always going to be the only one in the room, and that you either could cower under those circumstances or be brave. And Astraea often is the only one in the room. And I think that that bravery, to me, is synonymous also with optimism. I think that this idea of philanthropy, I didn't really realize what I was getting myself into when I thought about it.
No one ever does.
But I'm not foolish, and I understand that we live in a country whose disparity is predicated on the disparity of wealth, right? So that success and what it takes to live a life is related to resource. So it seemed a bold move to not just be a storyteller, but to step into the role of helping run an organization that was going to leverage resource and is the scrappy one, right? Astraea is a public institution. Astraea is a public foundation, but we give the most number of grants of public or private foundations to the Global South and East. We're in the top 10 of dollar amount and the only public on that list. So that means we have really good hustle, right? That's good at the very least, right? But we also understand resource goes beyond the dollar. And so to me, that's a compelling notion of philanthropy, that we're leveraging ideas, that we're in dialogue constantly, that knowledge is power. I mean, not to be trite, but that what it means to have this conversation in this room and then a totally different kind of room, to bring that conversation everywhere we go. And to understand, and to not really have to overstand the situation. To say, you know what, it's always about race, it's always about gender, that gender's not just about male, female, that it is in fact a fluid occupation. We can wear that in our body differently no matter the time of day, right? And that our rights shouldn't be predicated on our understanding of those things.
I will just say ditto to all of the values that Bob presented in her prior comments. I will also say that you're a new philanthropoid. Mm-hmm. That's the term of art.
Okay.
I don't know whether that, you know, it is still being used these days, but when I joined philanthropy a long time ago, uh-huh. 1983 actually, it was the first year I joined the Ford Foundation, that was the term we were told we could use to describe ourselves. But right now, I'm not a philanthropoid, I'm an ex-philanthropoid, and I don't know what that means, but I can tell you that one of the things that's really important about being a philanthropoid is optimism. If you are not optimistic that philanthropy can make a difference, you have no business being in the job. That's number one. And I'm happy to hear that you're by nature an optimistic person, because it's a slog. These are struggles that don't get solved in, you know, any single lifetime. It's not really about victory, although of course you want to be victorious. It's about being in it for the long haul and making a difference in whatever ways you can. So I want to say we're bookends. I left philanthropy in 2010, but I'm still thinking about it and writing about it. Mm-hmm. Just getting back to Carol's question, I became a philanthropist quite by accident, I have to say. I started out in academia. Mm-hmm. I was in graduate school and was the recipient of actually a donor fellowship, which meant I wasn't able to teach while I was in graduate school. And I felt that was a great loss, that, you know, they wanted you just to go straight through, which of course I didn't do. And I started teaching at a community college. In fact, on Staten Island, a place called Staten Island Community College, which is now the College of Staten Island. To make a long story short, we developed one of the first programs in women's studies in a community college at that time, and got attention for having done that, because I got into this whole world from the point of view that ideas matter, and that if you don't know what came before, that there were other generations that struggled with the same kinds of issues of race, class, gender, and sexual orientation, you weren't really going to be able to figure out how to take it one step further. So I wasn't a filmmaker, though while I was at Ford, I helped to fund a number of films. One of my favorites was something that Sherry Freelo did called Black Nations, Queer Nations, which nearly got me thrown out of the Ford Foundation. I kept saying, we're working in African American studies, and someone there kept saying, you're not working in African American studies, you're dealing with queer studies. I said, well, you know, one and the same, if you think about it. Needless to say, I will just say that I became involved in higher education reform, especially around women and gender studies. I was recruited to work in a federal agency in the U.S. Department of Education called FIPSE, which is a public foundation, and worked largely on, I would say, improving, FIPSE stood for the Fund for the Improvement of Postsecondary Education, improving curriculum and access for students who were not able to attend, because in those days the costs were high, now they're skyrocketing, and there's more to be said about that. And from FIPSE, I was recruited to the Ford Foundation to work on issues of women and gender studies and community college access to four-year colleges for community college students. So that's why I got into this business. And I'll stop there, only just to say one other thing, that philanthropy, which has now become a subject that I'm studying, there's a wonderful phrase of someone who was a kind of pundit in the 70s and 80s. He said, philanthropy is society's passing gear. And what I like about that is no one ever thinks that philanthropy is so risk-taking that it will just do something that no one has thought of doing. Much more that once an idea or a social movement or a curriculum or an institution begins to take root, philanthropy can kick it into passing gear. Accelerate the process of social change. Make social change more palpable. And I think the best of philanthropy is all about that. And most importantly, it is not about philanthropy. It is about making sure that other people are enabled to do and pursue their, not only dreams, but at the grassroots, improving the quality of lives.
And Linda, I just want to thank you as well for allowing me to be part of this conversation. Because when I first entered into the space, and before coming here, I was online looking at some of your work. And when I came in, the first thought I had was going, it was a flashback for me when I was a young child and I was watching Wonder Woman. And, you know, as a young man, you know, you would think, you know, or as a child, you know, why would you be watching Wonder Woman, right? I mean, it's a feminine heroine that you embrace to some degree, but at the end of the day, what you're looking for is a hero. You know, not only was I gravitating towards Wonder Woman, but as I was getting into comic books, the thing that was absent were people of color. Mm-hmm. And so I started to gravitate to Storm, who was the X-Men.
Yes. Right.
And so for me, it's interesting because here are these women heroines, and I was looking for a woman that was a woman of color. So for me, you know, while the Campaign for Black Male Achievements primarily focused on improving the life outcomes of black men and boys, for us, you know, the starting point for us is an intersectional approach. That gender and race intersect as well as class. And that we see this as a starting point of a conversation that has started and it has not ended and needs to continue for generations, which is one of power, one of privilege, and recognizing the ways in which these two things intersect and how they affect the lives of women and men and those who aren't gender conforming. Just a couple of things that I want to highlight that I think philanthropy can do to advance gender justice. And I think the first is that we have the power of convening. We can bring people into conversation that others aren't able to in different ways. The second, I think, beyond the power of convening and conversation is the power of catalyzing. To your point about how we can jumpstart issues and push issues to the forefront that others aren't necessarily willing to take. The other is around collaboration. I mean, the reason I'm here tonight is not just because I think it's important, because I believe in these issues and I believe in social justice. I'm here tonight because I believe in collaboration. I believe in partnering. And I think the only way we address these social issues that are at the core that affect everybody, we have to work together. And then the last thing I will say is cover. And what I mean by cover is that we need to be able to protect those individuals who are willing to take the risk around issues that others won't be able to do themselves. And I think about 2 years ago, I was at another event giving a speech with Crystal Haling from the Blue Cross Blue Shield Foundation. She's no longer there. And when she spoke, she was giving a very empowered speech. And one of the things she said is, you know, good philanthropy for me is when, I'm going to paraphrase her, I'm not going to completely quote her, is when every day you're taking a risk that you're so, before you push that button, that send button, that you're so nervous about what you're about to do. And that's how I approach my philanthropy, is that I'm a risk taker, I'm not an entrepreneurial type of philanthropist. That's how I would describe myself. I'm not there necessarily to make people happy. I'm there to kind of push the envelope, transform the way we think. To me, when I came to philanthropy, I kept saying, here's all these billions of dollars, and I know we spend trillions on issues, but here's all these billions of dollars, but we're still in the same point. That the ways in which, you know, I'm reading New York Daily News today, and here's a young black girl who is accosted by police officers, who's an honor roll student, walking down the street because someone put out on the PA, look, there's some black girls walking around who just shoplifted from our store. Now, for me, that's a black male issue, because Phil Koff and his research, what he demonstrates is the way in which people perceive black people, or black males specifically, when officers encounter black women, in their mind what triggers is black male, and that's how they treat them, with that disrespect. And that power is at different levels. So I think the intersectional approach of philanthropy is something that we have to embrace. And when we talk about gender equity lens, everything you said, Linda, I agree with. It's about, one is a numbers game, right? It's about, okay, how many people have this? How many people have that? But in the back of my mind, and the last thing I'll say is, I'm always thrown back to what educated me when I went through college and my own upbringing was womanism. And I think about the lives of black women specifically and how I as a man contribute to that oppression. And also, as men, how we unravel that oppression. So part of collaboration is being here this evening to say that I'm in solidarity, but not just in solidarity, but also as an ally to say that these are ways in which if I can, as a straight man who believes in gender non-conformation, who also believes in the LGBT community, can speak out on their behalf and work with them in unity, I think we can move the ball a little further. And I think that's what philanthropy can do. We need more people who are willing to challenge themselves and challenge the issues and push against the grain, but also recognize that we're not perfect. And I'm not here to say I am perfect as a man or as an individual, but that we need to work. And that's the challenge.
It just struck me that I am the only person on this panel who's not actually a philanthropist. Mm-hmm. So I think it's important to say that from the outset. But nonetheless, what I do is I think about the survival of queer people and queer communities every single day. And so I think about economics, both in terms of our own lives and our own well-being, and also the funding and sustenance of movements that recognize our struggles and recognize our experiences. And I'm happy to say that when IGLHR was formed 22 years ago, this was a priority. LGBT lives were the priority for very few people other than those of us in the community ourselves. And in 2012, we're talking about a radically different world, but one where the flow of money is becoming my obsession, because the progress of LGBT rights into the mainstream human rights framework means now, today, 2012, it's mainstream human rights organizations increasingly speaking for LGBT folks. And that's a problem. And when we talk about philanthropy, we have to layer it and still ask, you know, who is speaking for who? You know, I started by being a US-based community activist working at the intersections of women's rights and economic justice. And what I found is that we feminists, we economic justice activists, we New Jerseyans and New Yorkers, we were tearing ourselves apart. Because what we did was we siloed our movements and we siloed our struggles. And the kind of philosophy of interconnections that we were talking about earlier actually wasn't there in the practice of our activism. And so I started looking for a framework to actually connect struggles. And I found human rights. And human rights is flawed like so many systems of belief, especially those that focus on the state. But it gave me a framework for saying, I cannot understand me without understanding you. And so it was my own need to save myself and to save my communities that led me to recognize that the US government was repeatedly failing me. And so as a woman, as an American, as a human rights activist, I said, I need to learn from other struggles, because in the US I can't find all the answers. And that led me to international solidarity work, which is why I now work for IGLHR. And I think the most profound lesson I learn repeatedly that brings me back to why gender justice and philanthropy is so interlinked is because without resources, it is so damn hard to do this work. Mm-hmm. I'm sure every person in this room has killed themselves as volunteers, working long hours and weekends and late nights. And some of you have done it alongside. Some of you have done it in your shadow. And some of you helped pave the way for me. I think about when I was one of the collective members that started Blue Stockings, which is a bookstore here in New York City that was originally conceptualized, you know, as a fear as a queer and feminist community space. And we said, well, how can we fund ourselves? You know, we're anarchists and we're radical and none of us really have jobs, we don't have health insurance. Well, let's sell books. I don't know what we were thinking. No one wants to sustain activism through books, except for those of us that depend on books for survival. And so what I learned, you know, as a 21-year-old activist is that it's incredibly hard to work a day job and then do your activism from 6 to midnight every day, and Saturday and Sunday, if you're lucky enough to get Saturday and Sunday. And the thing is, it is very hard to change the status quo. And it takes all of us fighting to change the status quo. And the right has so many resources that we actually need to galvanize our own. A lot of that can come through volunteer and community building. I think in this space there's probably a strong critique of the perils of what is considered the nonprofit industrial complex. But it is a privilege that I get to work for activism and work for social change. And so that's one thing I would say is absolutely essential about gender justice and philanthropy, is that we get paid to imagine another world. And then another thing I want to say very explicitly and passionately as an activist who is housed within a queer organization and a queer movement, which is that if we don't have philanthropists that care about gender funding LGBT work, we are in very deep trouble. And I have seen the scarcity of resources, institutional and major donor dollars, that actually care about the lives of lesbians and transgender people, that actually care about the gendering of gay men. And I have seen the disparity that the tragedy of the HIV crisis has created in the global development of the LGBT rights movement. And so when I have access to activists traveling through New York City because they're here for a meeting or they're here for conversations with donors, it is very often people who are getting money through a lens that's focused on MSM. And that's real, and there's a crisis that prompted that. And it is a crisis that also captures my heart. But when we talk about what gender justice means, we have to understand that lesbians and trans folks are falling behind in the conversation about resources.
Jessica is talking about the scarcity of resources. And I know that we were working with Women's Media Center, and in that sphere, we all had the feeling that there was a lot of money being directed at women's activities, a lot of funding for women. And in fact, there wasn't. You know, it was less than 10%, it may be only 7% of all funding that's given that goes to specific women's issues. So I think it's like that lobster being boiled in the pot where you think, oh yeah, the money's coming, but, you know, there are these great funders and we're getting lots of money and millions going to non-specific efforts. So talk to us a little bit about why that hasn't budged, why we haven't been able to make progress in that sphere, and in fact, that for our issues here today, the money may be getting scarcer.
First and foremost, you're right, that in general, we probably peaked in the 1990s. Mm-hmm. And when I think about the Ford Foundation, which I know best, there was certainly more interest in support for, and I would say, conditions that supported issues related to women and gender justice, okay? That said, there were gaps. And let me just mention one, because Jess and I were talking about this, and I alluded to it when I talked about Black nations, queer nations. In the 1990s, the president of the Ford Foundation, Frank Thomas, who was the first African-American ever to head a major foundation, handed the baton to Susan Bairstow, who was the first woman to ever head a major foundation. I mean, now Rockefeller was headed by Judith Rogan, but Susan really was the first major philanthropoid heading a major foundation who was a woman. And things began to sort of accelerate. For example, one of my examples about gender justice, which is kind of old hat, but not really, is the support Ford gave to numbers of women's rights in the US and overseas NGOs. It was a very big and important area for the Ford Foundation. In the United States, for example, Ford was probably the founding foundation for something called the National Women's Law Center. And during a certain period of time, including, I think in 2005, Ford gave a $10 million endowment grant to the National Women's Law Center, which had to be matched. At the same time, program that I was responsible for made an endowment grant to Spelman College as a Women's Research and Resource Center, and an endowment grant at one-tenth the size of National Women's Law Center, sadly. So there was money, another grant to the National Council for Research on Women, which was endowed with support. That support peaked and began to shift. And I think there were many reasons for it, but I do want to say leadership matters. And to the extent that you have a feminist, an outspoken feminist leader, who may not be the most radical leader, and I wouldn't say that of any of the people at Ford in the 90s, helping to plot Ford's direction, and that made a difference, no question about it. However, we were nowhere with regard to LGBT issues in that era, and now Ford, I'm happy to say, is doing a little bit better on that front than it did before. However, the money probably came from other kinds of gender-related activity. That's my hunch. When I was casting around for examples of how philanthropy promotes gender justice, I thought of three, and one of them I've mentioned, the National Women's Law Center, which really, for those of you who know about Obama in his first week signing Lilly Ledbetter, that would not have happened had there not been a group like the National Women's Law Center in the United States. Another example, however, of promoting gender justice, which I had absolutely nothing to do with, was in Bangladesh. And in fact, the whole area, the whole social movement around women and microfinance was funded by Ford colleagues overseas. And I want to say that in some ways, that agenda continues, even though I see a diminution of support in the United States. We're in, I don't want to call it backlash, although it might be, but we're in a period of people saying, well, women constitute more than half of college-going students, therefore, this problem is going to solve itself. Not so. Let me stop.
I was looking at your fellows program, which is very exciting, and I want you to talk to us a little bit about that. But you had like 1,000 people apply to become a fellow, you know, working with black boys and black men. You're going to give out, what, 28 or how many? Tell us about that.
For some time, I think, particularly facing African-American community, both black men and black women have, to a large degree in this country, and I think it's true of a number of immigrant or minority communities as well, have been at the fringes and how they've been integrated. Now, you can look at class and look at how some people have made it, but when you look at the overarching dynamics facing black women and black men, those dynamics haven't really shifted much. In fact, to a large degree, they've worsened. And people don't want to talk about that. And I think part of the space of what I was saying earlier about the collective ways in which we talk about issues, we have to be willing to truth tell. And I think one of the uncomfortable things when we started the campaign, alluding to the question that you're asking me, was about what about black women and girls? What about Latinos? What about whites, poor whites? And to us, it's never either or. And I'm sorry that philanthropy sometimes sets it up that way. Because it puts us in positions where we're pitted almost against each other when that's not even the reality in which we're working. So Soros committed $30 million to match Bloomberg's $30 million, which they then matched $67 million towards the city's funding to improve the life outcomes of Latino and black males. And one of the things that Soros was looking at specifically and why we committed to it was more around the disparities around the school-to-prison pipeline, how young men particularly were being caught up with the criminal justice system. And so we were more looking at it from that perspective, the intersectionality approach of how do we advance this. But from our standpoint as a foundation, it's a race-gender issue. And so we looked at it from that standpoint, and then we engage with our advocates who push us and then say, what about women? What about girls? What about these issues? Why is youth development getting cut and schools getting more money? Mm-hmm. The thing is, sometimes philanthropy, what's unique about philanthropy, and Bob, you may agree with this, is that we get to see it inside of a process that others from the outside, when I was a grant seeker, I would never imagine a process of a grant maker. Right, and when you're in that process and when you recognize it, there's a lot of politics. When we first started mentioning a black male achievement, for a lot of people in their minds, they couldn't conceive achievement of black male. It wasn't so much it was a black male program. It was the issue was like, why not disconnect the youth? why not marginalize males? Like, why, what are you trying to say about black male achievement? Are you trying to say black men are better than everyone else? Or, and we were saying, no, it was a way for us to kind of actually force you to have that conversation. Why black men? And why do you think there's a challenge with us around perception? And I'm looking at the art, and I'm thinking about the ways in which we change behavior by the way we think and through culture. And the way, and that's why this space is important, is that we have to challenge the ways we see and perceive the reality in which we live. That's the reason we're investing in the fellows, is because it's a way for us to break out of our traditional brand new.
But I want to ask you about ARCUS, the foundation, and all the talk that I know. No. I know it's not yours. It's not hers. But in the entire funding of the LGBT movement, the fear that ARCUS, which is the largest, like $60 million over the course of the years, would change its focus.
At any of our foundations, right? Even at Astraea, our relationship to our grantees, if we cut funding to a single one of our grantees, we have to do it responsibly because it will simply affect them. Like, that's just real. So it doesn't matter if it's $60 million or $60. If that's a meaningful sum to you and that's how you live your life and you're able to do your work with that sum of money and you suddenly don't have it, it has implications. In philanthropy and or in activism, I think that there's this way that we perceive that we are fighting against the perception of success. And so that we can look at the 90s and say, oh, it was the heyday, because all of this wealth was poured into these ideas that were people thought suddenly deserved to be rich. But what happened in that moment, you also saw in the work of the day, and I think it's indicative of what it means now, for shifts, particular kinds of shifts in funding, is that you saw a grassroots mobilization born out of an identity politic. That because there were lesbian feminists, because there was a black power movement, because there had been now women's studies, ethnic studies, then we could claim a radical queer politic, and it wasn't divorced from our lesbianism, etc. For it to now come back around in 2012, but we got to claim our wins. That's what I want to say. We got to claim our wins. What you have now is other folks wanting to claim those wins. And that's the difference. Because our wins didn't look like wins to anybody else before. But now, a few of them do. Right? So gay marriage in its isolation looked like a win to somebody else who's not gay, right? Certain people of color getting to occupy a particular kind of space and not talking about anybody else that ever got them in that space is a win to some folk, right? And we'll just call it post-racial. But what happens if you want to claim that radicalism, right? In its broadest sense, we can't look to any one group for funding, right? We have to fund ourselves, period. And we have to look and we have to be convincing enough that in our case, LGBTQ rights are, given that they're inextricably linked to all of these other systems, then not only LGBTQ funders should be funding us. And so it should not matter what ARCUS does. Right, it shouldn't. Now, I'm not saying it doesn't, but it shouldn't, because there should be enough. It shouldn't be a disembodied fight.
I think one of the great things about Astraea and also about ARCUS has been that it has shamed some of the more mainstream, I'll call them liberal foundations, to re-examine their own priorities, and I think that's important. Mm-hmm. And I think there's always a dynamic between sort of the quote fringe, quote, which really isn't the fringe, but it's the next wave, and the center. And I would say one of the positive things that's happened is maybe ARCUS may be leaving the frame, but some others are coming in that hadn't been in before, and that may be important. And I say to Jessica, she just met with the new director of a new unit at Ford that didn't exist when I was there, which is a unit that looks at gay lesbian rights, that looks at HIV rights, and looks at women's rights. Now, what I like about it is at least it exists as a structural phenomenon. What I don't like about it is that it kind of ghettoizes all those issues and separates them from the human rights agenda, which is in another part of the Ford Foundation. So every time you have a win, you also have a loss.
Jessica, in following one of your tweets, I was taken to an international site, LGBT site, which was very, very interesting and much more, but seems to be much more to the violent, murderous edge than we are here in this country. But if you can talk with us a little bit about that on the international sphere and philanthropy that might go there instead of here, and whether or not you think the United States should withhold funding, for instance, to countries that that are not acting appropriately, responsibly.
Well, I mean, that's part of the neocolonial discourse, right? You know, the savage elsewhere, the human rights at home. And I think this group knows better. It's much easier to point the finger at someone else than to talk about our own failings. And actually, sometimes, pointing the finger somewhere else makes us feel like our own failings don't exist. Or silences the complexities that we have in our own communities, which is why the Bringing Human Rights Home movement has been so critical to actually saying, no, human rights violations happen every single day in the United States to communities of color, to communities of people with disabilities, to LGBT folks, to women. And this dichotomy is deeply problematic. And this is something that we have to say time and again under an Obama administration, when there's, you know, Democrats in the White House, when there's an LGBT-friendly State Department. We have to trouble these conversations deeply. And we also, as LGBT activists, have to ask, well, if an administration is investing in the most LGBT rights-affirming foreign policy in the history of this country, which I would say is what we have today, is our reality, and is something to celebrate, what is the cost to domestic LGBT rights struggles? And how is there a difference between what is said by the US at the UN and what actually results in policy changes for queer folks in the United States? The reality that the media sensationalizes anti-queer hate crimes in other countries is real. You know, and it's a compelling story to tell. And it sells copy. And that can't ever be forgotten, especially in a conversation about economics. It sells copy. The funding for LGBT rights work outside of the US and Europe, explicitly LGBT rights work rather than public health work or women's rights work that intersects, is less than $40 million internationally. Maybe others have the precise number, but it's so small, and it's unacceptably small. And especially as human rights activists who say, my well-being is connected to your well-being, we actually have to share the resources. So I think philanthropy needs to take a global approach, a genuinely global approach. And that's where I think the conversation about aid conditions becomes so critical, because today we're suddenly dealing with governments that claim to be LGBT friendly and are trying to figure out what that means in terms of bilateral aid. And that is a complex conversation. And so what we saw within the past year is we saw David Cameron, the Prime Minister of the UK, say, we will discontinue aid to communities and countries in crisis if they don't have LGBT rights friendly policies. And so activists, particularly in Africa, started a dialogue right away and said, wait a second, what does this mean? Because we're LGBT folks and we're also Africans, you know? And so what happened was there was a very public letter issued, signed on to by many activists who said, you know, don't simplify our lives. And it has been very influential, it has been influential among movements and among activists. I think that those in government and trying to be LGBT friendly in government aren't quite sure what to do with this issue. I would also say that there is diversity of opinion. I don't know if people in this room have been following what's been happening in Malawi, but Malawi is one of the countries where there actually are aid conditions predicated on LGBT rights. And activists in Malawi say, please continue the aid conditions. And last week, Joyce Banza, the new president of Malawi, declared openly that sodomy would be decriminalized in Malawi. And activists in Malawi are saying the aid conditions that have explicit LGBT rights elements were a part of, not the only thing, but a part of bringing this about. So long as there are aid conditions based on a human rights agenda, you have to ask, well, what are the measures of that human rights agenda, right? So if you say corruption in governance will trigger an end to aid, then you have to ask, well, where do women's rights fit into that? Where do LGBT rights fit into it? It's not so easy as to say LGBT rights can't be a part of the conversation. I'm not sure exactly where to land on this. Personally, I struggle with this, and I think IGLHR institutionally struggles with this, because I don't trust governments to have the level of nuance that we want. I will say, my shorthand, as we're thinking this through, this new possibility through, is to say fund movements, you know, fund activists, because the best advocates are the communities themselves. So if you really want to help a community in crisis, fund their work.
So we do have a couple of wealthy women initiatives underfoot. There's been
Women Moving Millions.
They've raised about $200 million. You don't get into that club unless you've given $1 million to a women's organization. There's a Women's Donors Network, which, you know, works in an array of spaces of extremely wealthy women who are giving some big dollars. So that, have you had any success at all in that area?
Even when you have women of wealth, they are not funding women in arts and culture. And so one of the interesting questions for me is how to think about women's philanthropy. In fact, if you look, you know, 10 years, 20 years down the road, I believe now women constitute, I think this figure is close to right, unlike Jessica, I'm not totally sure, 43% of all people with $1.5 million or more are women in the United States. And over the next 10 to 20 years, that figure is going to go up as there's an intergenerational transfer of wealth and as women outlast men. So the whole challenge, in my opinion, has to do with the education of women philanthropists. There have been really notable exceptions, but I would say, Carol, that is an area. In fact, it's one of the things we at Rutgers are going to talk a lot about. And while I was at Spelman, we had a conference on women and philanthropy and how women can be more, I'm going to call it, path-breaking in their philanthropy. And ironically, women are the backbone of volunteers in the arts and culture sector, but not necessarily involving themselves in financing the kinds of people that Kelly was talking about.
What is difficult, I think, to get funding for is exactly that long haul organizing. That organizing which brings the things together, which keeps the communities moving, which gets the voice, so that, for example, on the issue that you handled so well, Jessica, which I am very passionate about how do we understand the intersection of the local and the global, and how you need to guide U.S. foreign policy by the voices of the people in that country, and how do we, as organizers in the United States, know what the feminists or the LGBT activists in that country think, whether it's Malawi who wants, you know, this conditionality, or Uganda that doesn't, or other countries, you know, have different views. It's not really ours to decide, or it's certainly not the U.S. government's to decide whether to do conditionality. It's ours to work with people who are on the ground who can help us to come up with the policies that actually respond to the organizers on the ground. And I think it's that networking money, it's that capacity building. You look at women's human rights and we had an enormous impact, but we have very weak organizations 20 years later, because the money for building the capacity of organizations to last the long haul seems to me to be the hardest money. So I'd be really interested in all of you, you know, thinking about how do we make that a bigger priority and sort of how that works.
In terms of capacity building, currently, I think our strongest, we identify as a global foundation, which means that we do work nationally and internationally. It's much easier to fundraise for our international work. And we give capacity building and general operating support. And from our larger foundational supporters, we have to always justify that or pretend like that's not true, right? Our national work is centered around movement building. And when I was talking earlier about this notion of a win, too, I want to talk a little bit about that, because how are those wins measured? If you're looking for a measurable win, you can't also be looking for a long-term solution. However, it is incumbent upon us then to set the terms and to define our own metrics. And I think that we haven't been great at that because, you know, because that's the man. And so, but if we don't do that, somebody else is going to do it for us. So I think that we're really looking at how to make that so.
I mean, these are generational issues, and I think you're 100% right. We have to fund the organizations, and that's why I mentioned MIA, right? I mean, Third Wave Foundation has for a long time been at the crux, and they've had a basic strategy. Get the people who are most affected to be the donors and supporters, but also try to be an educator to philanthropy about the issues that others may not care about, and communities that others will always see at the margins. Women of color, who are trans identified or LGBT identified. And so I think that, one, we have to support the capacity of those groups. The challenge, at least for philanthropy, is that those groups, it's not just an issue of sustainability or funding the organizers, it's also working with them because they're under attack. There are communities that are suffering and that also need capacity, not just physical dollars, they need emotional support. They need supports around other issues. And so it's a constant, especially when we deal with Black-led organizations. There are organizations that, one, funders, they get 1% of the funding stream out of philanthropy, Black-led organizations. So with that said, there are organizations, because they never get capacity support, they're the first ones that funders will say, well, you don't have capacity. You don't have a board. You don't have money. And then they're the ones that never get the money. So it's a double-edged sword. It's a catch-22 in philanthropy. You either, and this is why I meant about risk. You have to be willing to say, look, I'm going to fund this group, even though they may not have a strong board, even though they may not have this, but then you have to be committed to help them build that up. That's and right. That's the long-term commitment.
That's right.
The one thing I won't diverge completely from Bob, but I agree 100%. What I loved most about what you were saying was about wins and claiming wins. And I think we have to learn to, at least those who care about this issue, to know we can win. And know that we are going to be able to win, even though it may not look that way. And I think that there's one thing about metrics and measurable wins, but there's one thing about articulating a vision of what that looks like. And I don't think we've done a good job of that. I don't think we know how we can work together across communities that are diverse to really work together. And then the last thing I'll say about art and culture, it's at the heart of what we do, strategic communications and art, because as I said, for us, the start of changing the ways policies are made around Black males and people of color is, one, starting with how they're perceived. If policies around criminal justice system are shaped by the ways in which people perceive Black men as animals or as criminals, then we need to change that because we're human.
I want to pick up with something you said, Charlotte, about the notion that we're always getting small grants. And I want to say there's a new problem, which is the obscenely large grants. So, you know, we called some friends in Turkey a few weeks ago who started a new organization, and they said, guess what? We got 350,000 euros from some British funder. And we were like, do you guys have an office space? And so they had access to the money. They can use the money. They're smart. They're brilliant. They're amazing. but there's also this challenge, which is being told, if you want the money, you have to grow obscenely fast, and you have to institutionalize. And then I think this is one of the questions that philanthropy must inevitably struggle with, the relationship between building movements and building institutions. And then I'm so happy we're talking about this question of like our own metrics, matrix, and wins, because I feel like one of the disadvantages of the human rights framework has been, you know, we focus so much on violations by the state. And so the notion of state violence is, okay, so if police brutality doesn't happen, then it's a kind of win, right? And if arbitrary arrests don't happen, it's a kind of win. But that focuses on a very narrow framing of our lives. And it means this long-term change and this movement building that we know we need to do to actually be proactive rather than reactive doesn't happen. So when IGLHRC adopted our new strategic plan, we said, we developed this 10-point criteria, and we said we're looking for partners that are at a tipping moment. And our funders said, well, we want to know that in 5 years you're going to decriminalize sodomy in 3 countries.
Why?
I'm going to answer that.
One of the great challenges is to push back against this notion that social change can be quantified, that you can find a metric for what IGLHRC does, and that, you know, large is better, and in fact, nothing counts unless it's, you know, 8 figures. Because at the end of the day, that perverts what is going on in the ground. You need to give more credibility and trust to the grantees than I think is going on at the moment.